Giving him easy means of transport. As time went on, industries were started, and rivers once again played an important part in their development. As man's ingenuity grew, he conceived the idea of making artificial waterways to link up with other towns and rivers in every part of the country. Many of our early canals were made from the Roman ditches, but it was the Duke of Bridgewater who first devised a scheme popularizing their use. With the help of James Brindley, a brilliant engineer who could neither read nor write, canals were constructed which connected the Humber, Thames, Severn, and Mersey. At this point, the canal branches off from the tidal river, and these large seagoing barges, too big for the canals, congest the entrance to the basin where goods are transshipped to smaller vessels before continuing their journey. To help them along past the gate which cuts off the canal from the river, a hydraulic capstan is used. This job looks simple enough, but it requires skill to seize the right moment to take the strain, and the tautening rope could easily break a man's ribs. Canals were first constructed to carry coal, but nowadays they transport every kind of merchandise, relieving the roads and railways and leaving them clear to carry war materials. With natural curiosity, British bees sample a consignment of West Indian honey, dew, and much to the annoyance of the dockers. Down the wharf, we see that other goods are being unloaded from boats. The clanking of cranes and the shouts from the foremen tell us that the canals are busy again delivering the goods. Soon the holds are empty, but without a pause they are filled with new cargoes. The merchants of Birmingham, Leeds and Manchester must not be kept waiting for their goods in these days, and within a few hours the barges are ready to set off on another trip. Crafts start their journey chugging along the winding waterway. Even the smoke-grimed city has a new charm, and the unusual angle of familiar buildings from the canal's path presents a fascinating scene to the visitor. As we sweep round the bend, the vista changes, and the many bridges flanked by buildings down to the water's edge give the scene an almost un-English atmosphere, reminding us of those picturesque canals which flow over Europe. Along the banks, fishermen gather, dreaming no doubt in the tranquil surroundings of much bigger fish than those playing round their lines. Soon the view changes once again. We are heading for the open country, and the high buildings have given way to rows of graceful trees. A famous Frenchman truthfully said that London owes much of its charm to the fact that every street has at least one tree. And that can be said of all our canals, however urban. Resuming our journey, we drift down a peaceful avenue of plane trees in their full summer glory. At last, the narrow waterway broadens out at the junction where three arms of the canal run. Here the barges make their way to the gauging shed before continuing their journey. The foreman knows the capacity of every barge and the depth to which they are loaded. A gauge is taken at each corner to ensure that they are carrying the correct weight and not overloaded. Gauging finished, the barges make for the open country, where they are free to travel at full speed, away from the congested waterways of the city. Man's faithful friend, the horse, is still at work along the towpaths, pulling the larger barges over short distances. For this work, they need many years of training, and the horse's task is not so simple as it may appear. Too sudden tension on a slack rope has been known to pull a horse into the water, and so he must know when to pull his load slowly. But most modern barges have oil engines and are capable of a speed of more than 10 miles an hour, though such a speed would tear down the banks with the wash. These inland craft fit neatly into the typical English scene, and for all their commercial purpose, add to its charm as they move in and out of the dappled sunlight. The Bargees are a community on their own, living their entire lives with their families on the canals. Literally, a floating population of many thousands. Every member of the family helps in handling the boat. Many of the older generation can neither read nor write, but at certain points, special schools have been provided for the youngsters. The barges mainly travel in pairs, the motor vessel towing the butty, as the second one is called, and carrying a combined load of some 50 tons. Accidents are almost unheard of, and canal transport today is the cheapest, most reliable, and frequently a quicker mode of conveyance than rail. The quaint, winding water lanes are kept narrow to conserve the water, and the stream has to be constantly supplied. The long, level stretches are linked by locks, and were it not for these, the mileage would often be doubled. Here the women do their share of the work, opening the gate while the man opens the sluice. This simple process of sailing uphill was not discovered until 1480 and made the whole canal system possible. Locks are kept as small as possible to save water, and neat steering is necessary to avoid damaging the gates. The sluice at the other end is open to allow the lock to fill up and the gate is closed. Although the level may have to rise or drop 12 feet or more, this operation takes little over a minute, though many locks have to be negotiated on a single trip. Soon they are able to move on again, and labor are expended in the efficient running of our canals, and at frequent intervals, along the waterway, repair centers are situated to keep the banks in constant repair. Here we see a sturdy oak on its way to the sawmill. This wood is used for building the massive lock gates, and in spite of the hard usage and pressure of the water, they last for 25 years, which speaks well for these craftsmen. But in spite of the sturdiness of these lock gates, they occasionally require attention. A slack period is chosen and the repair party get to work. The first job is damming off the gates with stout planks, and the men have to exert all their strength to sink them into position. The sluice gates are then opened and the water falls rapidly. Dog is more interested in rats. The repair gang have to work quickly in their workshop and locate the plank which needs room. Meanwhile, a few barges have appeared, but they will have to wait for the new wood to be tarred and nailed into position. The lock is soon refilled and the pressure of the water knocks up the planks as the level is reached. The bargee's well-earned rest is over, and once more the canal comes to life. But all canals are not constructed to carry barges, and here we get a glimpse of the famous Manchester Ship Canal, which links the city with the port of Liverpool. This huge enterprise was started in 1885 by Daniel Adamson, who foresaw the possibilities of making Manchester a port, thus giving her two vast industries, coal and cotton, an outlet. Meetings were held with the Lancashire manufacturers, who ultimately gave the scheme their support. Over £9 million was raised, and in less than 10 years, the canal, 35 miles long, was opened for use by Her Majesty Queen Victoria. As on smaller canals, the construction of locks was necessary at several points to make the scheme possible. The hard-working little tugs nimbly tow the large ocean-going ships neatly through the gates of the gigantic locks, which accommodate vessels of 15,000 tons dwarfing the countryside beyond them. Here the gates are electrically controlled, and powerful pumps force in thousands of gallons of water from below, the whole operation only taking a matter of minutes. This canal is the busiest in the country, and throughout the day, vessels pass to and fro, bringing their valuable cargoes to Manchester. Double locks have been built so that there is no delay, and the waterway is wide enough for two ships to pass each other. Soon the massive lock is filled and the gates part, allowing the ship to glide towards the sea. Further downstream, we reach Barton Bridge, which forms a gate to the city of Manchester. And here we pause to see the unique spectacle of the Bridgewater Canal, carried in an aqueduct above the ship canal. Thus, two waterways cross, yet each works quite independently of the other. The signal of an approach from the control tower, the machinery is set into motion, and slowly the smaller canal swings aside, hardly losing a drop of water. Bankrupt Manchester's cotton trade, and looking through the typical mist, an oncoming ship is seen. Traffic on the roadway is stopped, and the massive bridge swings aside to make room for the vessel. Down the name of the ship as it slowly glides past the bridge. The decks come level with the smaller canal, making it appear almost like a toy. The ship canal not only puts Manchester in the unique position of being an inland port, but places it as the third largest in the country and has contributed considerably to the commercial importance of the city. Vast docks cover a wide area and provide berthing space for hundreds of ships which daily defy attacks from the enemy and come from every corner of the globe. Foodstuffs and raw materials from America find their way to this busy port, besides raw materials from the local trades. or presenting scenes of bustling activity which continue throughout the day. Here is an example of the ingenuity and skill of our engineers and the enterprise of our industrialists who have successfully carried out the ambitious plan for the benefit of Manchester. Along the waterfront, powerful cranes swing the cargoes from the holds, and here again we see something of the Mancunian skill. These cranes are fitted with a special remote control device invented by a dock foreman, which considerably speeds up unloading. The use of a portable switch enables the operators to swing loads from the ship to waiting lorries with a nicety which was impossible by the older method. Years the canals suffered through the competition of more modern means of transport, but today they have come into their own again, and nearly 3,000 miles of navigable canals are relieving the congested lines and sidings of the railway. Thus, these inland boatmen, with typical determination, are making the canals of Britain play their part in the united effort.